Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Fearless Woman's Guide to Starting a Business. What every woman needs to know to be a courageous, authentic, and unstoppable entrepreneur. By Ameé Quiriconi. Narrated by Megan Tusing. Each friend represents a world in us, a world possibly not born until they arrive. And it is only by this meeting that a new world is born. Anais Nin, The Diary of Anais Nin, Volume 1, 1931 to 1934. Foreword. I walked into my local bookstore recently and noticed that about a quarter of the shelf space was taken up with business books. I wasn't surprised. There's a reason that there is an entire category of books about building companies. A lot of people aspire to be entrepreneurs, and many of those people want a map or a checklist for how to do so successfully. Unfortunately for those that like to follow well-defined steps, there's no one right way of starting a business. The possibilities are nearly as infinite as the combinations of company missions and founder attributes. If there was a simple instruction manual, there would be far fewer books on the subject. That's why I love the approach Ameé takes in The Fearless Woman's Guide to Starting a Business. Don't let the title mislead you. This book is much more about understanding and evolving yourself than it is a recipe for business processes. And that's what makes it impactful. Before embarking on a new journey, such as that of a business owner, it's valuable to reflect back on where you've been. This is something I've done many times on my own nonlinear path, and it's also an exercise that we lead women through on Own Trail, the company I co-founded to provide a peer-to-peer support system for women. Looking back gives us the opportunity to observe patterns in how we navigate experiences, take inventory of our internal resources, and be conscious about what behaviors and beliefs we want to carry forward with us and which ones we should leave behind. Ameé provides insights into psychology, neuroscience, and statistics to help readers uncover where we're coming from so that we can better understand where we are headed. This approach is valuable for anyone, and particularly so for women, as our personal and professional lives are so inherently intertwined. Many business books only focus on the professional dimension of ourselves, which can really sell our experience short and overlook crucial parts of our entrepreneurial journey. As Ameé put it, despite the desire to flip switches between your normal brain and business brain, it's all one brain. While Ameé's insights into developmental neuroplasticity, gender roles in finances, and frameworks for resiliency are incredibly valuable, it's her focus on authenticity that particularly resonates with me. It takes so much mental work to conform to values or norms that are not authentic to us. Mental work that could be going into building successful, innovative businesses. When we are authentically aligned with our businesses, it keeps us going through the difficult parts and frees up mental space so that we can be more creative and productive. And, as Ameé points out, our customers notice it too. You can't make that real connection with your customers unless you are real with yourself. In order to build an authentic, trustworthy brand that centers customers as people rather than commodities or sales channels, we have to be authentic and trustworthy ourselves. The interesting thing about becoming more authentic is that it looks different for everyone, because we have all experienced different familial and societal influences. We all have different internalized biases that can challenge our levels of authenticity. One of the exercises that Ameé leads readers through is based on owning stories and crafting future narratives. I love this process, which is very aligned with the way women share their trails on Own Trail, because it's a powerful act of reflection and visualization. The way we connect the dots of our past experiences can both show us how much we have accomplished and made it through so far, and help us imagine how the path that has led us here can evolve to so much more, including that of a successful business owner. As someone who recently left my corporate executive career to start a company myself, I know how enticing the idea of a playbook can sound. Starting a business is risky and unpredictable and can leave you feeling vulnerable. I've had to learn new job functions quickly, deal with external events outside of my control, and weather countless ups and downs. But I also know that the resources that have gotten me successfully through my first year of entrepreneurship aren't ones that can be checked off a list. They are exactly the resources that Ameé helps readers to identify and evolve in themselves. Self-awareness, vision, authenticity, resiliency, and a supportive community. While Ameé doesn't sugarcoat her message, it's ultimately an optimistic one. We all have the ability to grow in the areas we need to. If you are passionate about your why for starting a business, Ameé will give you the how. Enjoy your entrepreneurial journey. You've got this. Rebecca Bastian, CEO and co-founder of Own Trail, author of Blaze Your Own Trail. A book for all women, spelled W-O-M-X-N. If this is the first section you read while deciding if you should buy this book or not, I want to be clear that this book is for all women, spelled W-O-M-X-N, and words do matter. Some of you may have arrived at this place of womanhood through a long, hard-fought battle to uncover your authentic selves by waging war against the belief systems that said your biological sex and gender were the same thing. The same rule of thought we've all been living under. A rule of thought that still exists today, as many of you know, in professional settings as well as our personal communities. I also realize that a few of you have found yourself in a place where you have fearlessly shrugged off a gender label altogether, despite our society's ardent attempt to repeatedly stick it back on you. And I would venture to guess that some of you are men, interested in expanding your own views of the world and your awareness of how business is different for women. Or maybe you just want to learn how to be a courageous, authentic, and unstoppable entrepreneur, in which case, this book will definitely do that for you. In this book, I am using my voice as a person raised as a woman, spelled W-O-M-A-N, who was told how to live and behave as a woman. As you read, you will see this term repeated because, like I mentioned earlier, words do matter. Therefore, I am speaking to you as someone who has struggled to thrive, personally and professionally, with the weight of that word and its association with certain expectations, among other things, on my shoulders. And you will see, I will share the research and evidence of how these beliefs impacted all of us and what to do to cast them away so that we can be amazing entrepreneurs. Since there are no children reading this book, then the facts are that the mark of gender is already here in our adult lives, like fossilized footprints on our pathway. It influences us on conscious and unconscious levels. We can choose to change our future and give gender stereotypes a reduced power over us, but if we try to pretend they don't exist, we risk our footfalls echoing them back to us. That's why it is important for me to let you know that how the world saw you when you were growing up is what I am speaking to here. And as we move together through this book, I want you to keep in mind that the beliefs our parents and cultures have about gender and how these beliefs undermine women in business is what I have put on trial for us to cross-examine. And despite how my title is worded, I am not promoting a limited view of gender that continues to marginalize and limit all women and our capacity to do great things together. Introduction. Grab a drink. Let me set the stage. The scene is happy hour at a cocktail lounge, and there is a group of women sitting around on plush couches with dim lighting, taking full advantage of half-price drinks. You and I have never met, but we have a shared friend who invited us both to join this weekly ritual of socializing with adult beverages. Apparently, this group of women gets together regularly, to muse about their side hustles, bosses, coworkers, and otherwise share their frustrations with sympathetic and understanding ears before most of them peel off and head home. There, many of them then assume the other roles of mother, wife, or whatever else is always waiting for them at the end of every day. At some point during the conversation, the topic turns to starting a business. Suddenly, your ears perk up because you have been thinking about doing this for quite some time now. You have been making handmade jewelry for years and have often wondered if you could turn it into a full-fledged business instead of just a hobby. So, sensing a pause in the conversation, you take the opportunity to then speak up and ask the group, "I want to start my own business and don't know where to begin. What do you guys recommend?" Our mutual friend pops up in her seat and says, "Oh, wait, you have to hear this. This is why I asked her to come tonight." She turns to me and says, "Ameé, tell everyone your story." Our friend then nestles, rather dramatically, if you ask me, back into her seat, clutching her glass of wine, preparing herself for the long haul, with a shit-eating grin because she knows what's next. Feeling uncomfortable because I normally prefer to remain a fly on the wall and ease myself into a group of people I don't really know, here I am being singled out. I lift myself up from my hiding position I had taken on the couch, reach out to grab my margarita off the table in front of me, and take a long sip on the straw. I look around into the faces of everyone in our circle, all looking back at me. And then I turn to you and ask, "Well, do you want to know the easy way or the right way?" You look right back at me and without hesitation say, "Definitely the right way." And just like that, you didn't know it, but you and I instantly become friends. So, as your friend, I want to make sure that as I answer your question, I get right to the point as directly as possible. Because I don't know if I'll ever see you again, but I want to make damn sure that I make an impression on you that will leave you thinking about our conversation for a while. Because I have codes I live by, and one of them is that there is no bullshit to be found in my world. You will know where I stand and the only motivation behind what I say, no matter how pointed or salty it seems, is that I really do want to see you win. Now, before you ask, no, I have not personally turned myself into a multimillionaire with anything I've done so far. So why is my experience even worth sharing? Well, you see, in business, I've done some pretty cool things and have done them really fast. It's what makes me a good coach and teacher. I've had an instinct for many things related to business, as well as an insane curiosity to keep learning and become an expert in any field I wanted to, giving me a huge toolbox to build and create with over the years. My journey into entrepreneurship started back in 2003. That year, I invented a countertop out of garbage, literally, that sold $500,000 a year and diverted several million tons of trash from the waste stream. Yes, I turned trash into money and sold it to supermodels and rock stars. But I lost it all 8 years later. It was shortly after my marriage ended, and I blamed it on the extreme pressure of the recession and many other things I will talk about later. Right after that, I moved to the country and grew a backyard wedding business earning less than $10,000 a year into an award-winning six-figure business in less than 2 years. But then I expanded it to two locations, tripled revenues, and over the next 5 years, it would earn nearly $2 million in gross sales. This business went from losing money to earning stupid amounts of it. So I do know about starting from an idea at a kitchen table to growing a business to the multi-million dollar level, which is why sometimes people are interested in what I have to say. But the reason my friend is so eager to sit back in her seat and listen to the stories she's already heard me tell is that I know how to do all of that and have nothing to show for it. Zero. Zilch. Nada. Because in 2017, I lost it all again. Another relationship and another business. and I just knew I couldn't blame a recession or a terrible business partner or a lousy marriage again. Instead, I stood in the wake of loss and saw for the first time it was all on me. I didn't know why it was, but my mathematical brain could see a pattern, and that I was the common denominator in the rising and falling of everything I did. Here, I had lots of verifiable successes on the business front to point to. Television appearances, magazine features, famous customers, and on and on. But once it was said and done, I had nothing but a box of memories in my hands as I had to go find a new place to start over again. I wasn't wealthy like I imagined, and I wasn't happy. I was stressed and broke and thought I was destined to never get what I wanted. I truly believed that I was cursed with too many big ideas that were never meant to be mine. That I could dream up the fantasy, turn it into money, but that I was never meant to keep it. And that was horseshit. That's when I sat on my couch and decided that I would use my curious and creative mind on myself for once and solve the puzzle of what was happening. And then I spent 2 years doing just that. But a funny thing happened while on the journey of personal discovery. Lightning struck again. About 4 months into this healing process, feeling an intense sense of purpose, I was compelled to share what I was learning with others. So I decided to start a podcast called One Broken Mom. And in only 1 year, I would go from reading life-changing books to actually meeting and interviewing those very authors on my show. And several of these women and men would go from being the names on the cover of my favorite books to professional colleagues and even friends. But after spending a couple of years immersed in the field of psychology, neuroscience, and self-help, all while continuing to coach women business owners, I began to see the natural intersection between the two more clearly. My reasons for failure were not mine alone. And that's when I knew I needed to do something about it. See, my passion for my entire life has been to cheer on the underdogs. I have always felt like a superhero, not because of an overinflated ego, but because when the odds are stacked against someone, which is the case in entrepreneurship, and more so for women, it's nice to know that somewhere out there, someone has your back. And ever since I was a little girl, I have felt like that was my job. But my character has another side. I hate the idea of always having to save people when I know there's a way to change the system to keep people from needing saving in the first place. So, I study. I stay curious. And I stay rebellious. If you tell me something and my gut tells me differently, I figure out who's right and why. And then I tell the world. So I guess I'm not as much a superhero as I am a vigilante. That's why I will warn you that sometimes this book is going to feel like I'm talking you out of doing your own thing. But the truth is, I feel like if you are going to jump into entrepreneurship, I want you to do it bigger and better than you ever imagined. But also living for the first time in my adult life without a spouse or partner for several years, I know how important financial autonomy is for everyone. But more importantly, for women. And since few things we need to survive in this world are free, businesses or careers can be vehicles to take us to lives better than we ever thought possible for ourselves and our families. So, I thought about if you ask me, what should I know? Well, this book is what I wish someone would have told me before I started and failed and started and failed again at my own companies. Because I had talent, good research, great people management skills. I was a fucking closer when it came to sales. Long-term visioning and planning, cash flow projections and budget management, strategy, all of it. All of it. But in the end, I didn't know myself nearly as well as I knew my target markets, my customers, or my employees. So, yes, there are lots of business books written by women who have had some challenges in life, but fast-tracked themselves to success. I am not that author, and this is not that book. Instead, this book is built from the rubble of failures, And I think that's a good thing. Because the reality is, most people are going to fail many, many times. And when they read books by people who made it look easy, almost too easy, and they still can't pull off their own success, it reinforces this sense of inner shame that they are not good enough. And I just can't stand for that. It's not fair when I know the truth and I know how to help them. That's why I wrote this as a conscious, shifting, life-altering, pulling back the curtains and seeing the real wizard, holy shit kind of business book. The business book you read before you start a business. So here's a question then you might ask yourself. How do you know that what I'm writing about works, given the fact that I just told you how often I've messed up? Well, aside from my modest achievements in life, the proof is in the simple fact that you are reading this book. See, I am living right now in the most challenging era of life I've ever been in. A single mom with two teenagers, overcoming the impacts of abusive relationships, working a full-time job, and pulling myself up and out of financial deficits I created over the years. Unlike other self-help or business authors, I didn't have an encouraging partner to share the burdens life brought, such as helping with paying the bills, cooking meals, or attending school meetings, so that I would have free time to write this book. Nor was there someone here to offer me a sweet, soft kiss on the forehead at a moment when I may have needed my spirit lifted or my back rubbed. Not to mention, during my writing schedule, the coronavirus swept across the planet, adding a whole other surreal dynamic to everyone's lives that just made things weird and scary. And if I had chosen to give up or slow down, I don't think anyone would have blamed me. And yet, because of everything I learned and unlearned about myself, I am taking actions to change the course of my future. I am stealing time when I can get it to keep growing myself and to help others along the way. But most importantly, I know how to set a vision for myself so powerful that nothing, not even the worst, loneliest days, can take that mental image away from me and make me quit on it. I am unstoppable. Now, lots of people have exactly the life I want. Financial security, fulfilling work that changes people's lives, and freedom to travel to every corner of this planet. And there are lots of people that have the life you dream about, too. You want to know the difference between us and them? It will be here, in this book. It is a mastery of ourselves and our minds. It is raising our emotional intelligence. It is debunking myths we've been told about what our roles as women are supposed to be. And it is understanding that the keys to motivation, resilience, money management, assertiveness, planning, and balance are all based on how our human brain processes memories and emotions. Seriously. So, I want to help you lift the blindfold from your eyes and show you the real world. I want to dismantle your doubts and bad habits and help you rebuild into the woman you need to be to do this. Why? Because I believe women in business will be a powerful shift in this world. And not everything we've been taught is detrimental to us. Our skills and abilities we were groomed to have, and which can hold us back, also have upsides that make us a different kind of leader in businesses and communities. These skills are needed in this day and age. And the women who recognize that they have this power and awareness in them, think of the possibilities. You do not have to want to be a CEO of a huge corporation to benefit from this book. Every single little thing we all do to share our gifts and talents with the world, and are rewarded for doing so, breathes fresh air into our universe. Every woman who gets to fulfill her dreams enriches humanity. When we manifest the lives we were meant to live, not the life someone told us to live, it immediately generates happiness in ourselves that we end up sharing with everyone we come into contact with. It is really that simple. So, you asked me, what does it really take to start a business? Well, order another round and sit back, because, sister, I'm about to tell you. Chapter 1. Princesses, unicorns, and astronauts. No matter where you're from, your dreams are valid. Lupita Nyong'o. What did you want to be when you grew up? I know that starting with remembering all of the wonder and awe about the world we had as children does not seem like it can have any benefit for deciding what kind of business you want to begin. If you ask any of us what we wanted to be when we grew up, you'd get a myriad of answers that range from ridiculous to insightful, such as a princess, veterinarian, astronaut, rock star, or President of the United States of America. But there are some truths that can be found in our childhoods that can help us understand who we really are as people. In fact, it's in the purity of childhood, before expectations and grooming fully took over our direction and sense of self, that can help us see who we were always meant to be. And maybe what you wanted to do when you were 8 years old is unrealistic, but think about when you were 12, 16, or 18 years old. I bet you didn't believe in unicorns then, but you did believe in something, right? My earliest memories of what I wanted to do were to be a writer at 5 years old, and I carried my love for writing with me throughout my childhood and into adulthood. I would write poems and send them to the newspaper to be published or writing contests. And when I was in middle school, my entrepreneurial side began to emerge when I began writing poems for classmates and selling them for $5 each. But most importantly, I was a prolific journal keeper from the age of 11 until I started high school. Writing was, for me, a way to make sense of my inner world. Having moved around a lot as a child, I did not stay in a single school much longer than 1 year at a time. But after being at one school for 2 years, I was identified as gifted and given an opportunity to work with a counselor on activities to stimulate my talents and interests. And naturally, I chose writing. So throughout middle school and in high school, I would meet up with the local poet-in-residence in my hometown to hone my skills. And sometimes, for fun, I'd work with musicians so that I could write songs, because I also dreamed of being a rock star. In fact, music is my love language. Unfortunately, I suffered from nightmares growing up due to post-traumatic stress that wouldn't be diagnosed until my 40s. As a result, I developed a passion for the brain and the study of psychology. That's when I began to also use the extracurricular time I was given in high school for studying Freud, Jung, and theorists of psychology and dream analysis. In fact, back in 1989, at the same time that a new field called computational neuroscience was emerging, I wondered if the signals in the brain that allow us to see our own dreams in our minds were similar to the ways the eyes see and deliver information to the brain. So I theorized that if we could take that signal and put it on a monitor, a psychiatrist could see the dream and its details in order to help a patient neutralize nightmares and make sense of their subconscious. I hadn't quite worked the specifics out, but it seemed like a cool idea. Now imagine being a 17-year-old girl describing all these ideas to her parents who barely made it out of high school. It sounded more like science fiction and not an actual career. But while my ideas fell on deaf ears at home, my gifted counselor encouraged me because to her, it seemed I had a clear path and direction to take once I graduated from high school. Looking back, I would agree, it was obvious. But the problem was that at the time, my family didn't think so. Instead, I had intense pressure to not be a writer or a psychologist or be in music, because those people don't make any money, and since no one else in the family is good at it, I was told I won't be either. And despite how much time and effort I spent learning and writing poetry, my mother thought modern poets were weird, and it was all fodder for her jokes and teasing. Now, at the time, my high school boyfriend had an older brother in college who was finishing up his engineering degree. So he also wanted to be an engineer and thought we should do it together. My family latched on the idea, and so it was between him, my family, and my deep feelings to not let any of them down. That being an engineer was what I apparently wanted to do too. I bet my experience is not that unique, because this is how most of our lives play out. During a period of time when decisions are made for you, which is the bulk of a typical American childhood, our independent and autonomous identities are largely ignored. And parents either think they need to craft you into mini versions of themselves, or into a role that fits their needs or wants better. And oftentimes, our parents simply lack the skills to understand how to see our true nature, potential, and purpose. And through no fault of their own, they didn't know how to encourage us to grow. Instead, many parents relied on the time-test parenting strategy of knowing what's best for you. So even though I had a supportive adult in the form of my gifted counselor, Anne was her name, by the way, it could not overpower the will and influence of my family. So I got an engineering degree just like they wanted. How does this happen? Why did parenting and childhood look like this for so many people? First, I have some shocking news. It's because all our families are a little messed up. Yes, it is true. There is no such thing as the perfect family. Despite a parent's best, most loving intentions, hardships and stressors are a part of life. And there are many stresses in our families these days that are so common. They feel like a normal part of growing up and nothing to be concerned about. Or more commonly, some of us feel that we've overcome them without understanding the real long-term impacts. But just how many of us had to grow up with these hardships and challenging families? In 1998, a groundbreaking study by the Centers for Disease Control and Kaiser Permanente showed the relationship of adverse childhood experiences, known as ACEs, we have in our first 18 years of life to adult health problems. Aside from seeing how adversities and trauma in childhood increase the risk for developing health conditions, the other major findings were that these ACEs occur across all socioeconomic, racial, and gender populations, and that roughly two-thirds of all households have at least one ACE. Additionally, about 20% of adults in the study experienced three or more ACEs in the first 18 years of life. And in the results of the study, more women reported three or more ACEs in their lives than men. So what are these ACEs? Well, they include witnessing or experiencing emotional or physical abuse, including spanking and yelling. ACEs also include living in poverty, having a parent with substance problems like alcoholism, sexual abuse, emotional neglect, and even divorce. In fact, further research has shown that other experiences can be traumatic or stressful for children and have long-term impacts on our health, like experiencing racism, being bullied or teased, watching a sibling being abused, surviving the death of a parent or other close family member, and so forth. While some of the experiences seem like obvious traumas, I've met and spoken with a lot of people, and many never think about, for example, being spanked as a child or having a parent yell in your face when they were angry, because everyone's parents did that. And so, a lot of people don't view their childhoods as adverse, but only normal. Finally, most of us look at the list and can, for example, identify with growing up with divorced parents and think that it's also no big deal, because that is your past and has nothing to do with you today. And yet the evidence says otherwise for many of us. Who we are, nature versus nurture. We all know the age-old question, is it nature or is it nurture that makes us who we are? And thanks to advances in science and research, we now know the answer is that it's a bit of both. And that's why I'm challenging you, as you read this next section, to question how much of who you believe you are and what you believe you want is related to how you learned to fit into your family or is an authentic expression of who you really are. Now, when families have some degree of dysfunction, even if it's a temporary situation like a divorce, human brains work to manage or fix this dysfunction within our family system. And one way is to create order through family members settling into roles. I know I don't need to tell you that family dynamics are complicated, even in good families. And most of us, at one point or another, end up falling into a position or role within our families. Roles in families end up bringing order to dynamics. But especially if the home and family we grew up in was disorganized or under stress. Sometimes the parents assign roles to their children, and sometimes children develop them on their own. But the problem is that a role we played in our family was a survival tactic and may not actually be reflective of our true selves. This concept of seeing these roles develop in families in place of authentic identities was first presented by family therapist and author Virginia Satir in 1988. By studying families for decades, she noted that the role a child assumes in the family is in response to compensating for dysfunctions in communication. She also saw that this role becomes the basis for shaping the personality of the adult the child grows into. But sadly, she noted that the roles a child played easily overwhelmed an individual's ability to be themselves. In other words, the better you played your part, the harder it became to change. Over the years, researchers and therapists have seen five major roles develop in families. And while they may have slightly different names, my favorite breakdown is here. The hero, often the oldest sibling who is responsible for solving the family's problems. The golden child lives on a pedestal of achievements and is the center of attention. The scapegoat, always in trouble, blamed for problems, or refuses to follow the family rules. The mascot, often the youngest, who uses humor to shift focus from discomfort or dysfunction. The lost child, the one who feels like the outsider in their own family and disappears. If you begin to reflect on your family today and as a child, do you notice if you had or currently have a role? Sometimes we know what role we played by any nicknames people in your family gave you. Were you the smart one, or the jock, or the clown? Were you mother's little helper, or daddy's girl? Were you the big sister, or the baby in the family? As you grew older, did your role change a bit? Say, from the golden child to the scapegoat when you got into high school? Or was your role less obvious, but you were always told things like, "Oh, honey, I don't know what we'd ever do without you." Or did you become the one your mother asked for advice all the time or your father complained to? Often we started playing a role in our family to gain our parents' attention, but how important it was for us to stay in that role to make the family dynamics livable for everyone depended on our family of origin's levels of dysfunction and differentiation. While we do have inherited qualities in us that define our temperament, it is also true that our family system influences our sense of self. Dr. Murray Bowen, a psychiatrist, originated a theory of human behavior that a family was one interconnected emotional unit. This means that families tend to groupthink, and the emotions of everyone in the family feed off one another. People in the family will vary in how susceptible they are to this, due to nature and nurture. And this variability impacts a person's ability to develop a high or low sense of self-identity. People with a low sense or poorly differentiated sense of self rely on acceptance and approval from other people. It's as if how well they are doing in life can only be determined by what others think of them or do for them. On one side of the low self coin, a person may always be adjusting themselves to fit or appease another person's view of them. While on the other side of the coin, a person may be manipulating the people around them to get everyone to conform to their standards. So, for example, if you have a parent or caregiver who has a low sense of self, their viewpoint is that you are an extension of themselves. Your emotions are their emotions. And if you are upset, they want you to stop being upset so that they can stop being upset. If you want to do something that they would never do, they work to interfere with that or prohibit you because it doesn't fit their own needs. or it raises discomfort for them. To manage their discomfort, a parent might control how you dress or what music you could listen to, as well as what activities you are forced to do or not allowed to do, like music or sports. This type of parental control tactics can range from the passive-aggressive use of guilt to punishments for not doing what they want you to do. They are attempting to create you in their image because it's easier for them to handle or because they think they can. See, throughout most of history, a guiding thought was that all children are born as a blank slate and are the property of their parents. So we could be made into anything they wanted us to be. This theory can be traced back to Aristotle, but was made very well known by 17th century empiricist John Locke. Simply put, the belief latched onto by parents and educators was that all of us are born needing to have our caregivers tell us what to do, how to think, and how to behave. So this idea of a blank slate set a tone in parenting and our educational systems that made it seem like you could write onto any child's mind who you wanted them to be through repetition, punishment, fear, and consequences. If there was resistance to the desired outcomes, nobody knew that it was just the child's true individual nature rebelling. Instead, it must mean that the tactics were wrong, and perhaps greater force needed to be applied. The result was that as your own natural personality started to emerge, if your parents didn't notice or nurture it, but instead they pressured you to change, you didn't actually change who you really were, and you learned to simply adapt. And today, this all is considered emotional neglect, the disregard and dismissiveness of a child's temperament and emotional needs, which is also an ACE. If, however, you had parents or caregivers with a high or well-differentiated sense of self, they could easily see that everyone is an individual, and that your emotions, behaviors, and needs were your own, and they didn't feel a need to sequester or control them. It doesn't mean that your choices don't impact them emotionally, but it does mean that they are not at the mercy of those feelings. They were likely calmer and didn't feel threatened as you began to individuate. You were likely given room to explore and flourish. And to be honest, if this was your entire family, you are probably in the minority. In the end, when we have a family dynamic with a lot of people with poorly differentiated self-identities, it means we may have grown up with the overarching specter of needing to gain approval or acceptance from others. And this may have included completely giving up on what we want or believe just to make someone else happy. Dr. Lindsay Gibson, the author of Recovering from Emotionally Immature Parents, points out that parents with low self-differentiation tend to be quick to judge and ridicule other people's inner worlds or inner self. In extreme cases, some of us grow up with a fear of expressing who we really are and what we really believe in. The constant barrage of questioning and dismissiveness directed toward us about what we want or feel then creates a lack of trust with our own inner world and cuts us off from our own awareness of our life's purpose. The emotionally immature parent then may invalidate your dreams and undercut your decisions because you threaten their existence. They can't see you as anything other than extension of themselves or the overall family identity. So, to survive this environment and to maintain our connection with our parents, or risk the loss of their love and acceptance, we turn against our own thoughts, and we learn to build a facade. We shut down and play the role in the family drama to make life easier for ourselves and not rock the boat. But let me point out something important here, too. Our parents or caregivers probably loved us, cared about us, and just wanted what they thought was best for us. In fact, that is probably truly the case for many of you reading this. And as children, we are wired to maintain our connection with our caregivers because it's a matter of life or death. We need them to want us and take care of us. So, when well-meaning adults are telling us what they want us to do or want us to be, even if inside of us it doesn't feel quite right, We are apt to follow their guidance just because, at the end of the day, we don't want to break that connection. Children are, by nature, people-pleasing. That means being sidelined from pursuing your dreams or not doing something you're talented in and passionate about is oftentimes the tragic result of the interactions between loving human beings who simply didn't know the long-term consequences of what they were doing to one another. And the wonderful thing about life is that while you may have put your own pursuits on hold in order to be what your parents and caregivers wanted for you many years ago, you don't have to keep doing it anymore if you don't want to. The family belief system. Beliefs that our families held can be like fingerprints smudging up the screen on a smartphone. They can distort our views, even slightly, and despite our attempts to wipe them away, they seem to come back again. And we will keep coming back to them in this book because they can have a huge impact on our success as entrepreneurs in many areas when we don't realize we're unconsciously following them. And what's tricky is that beliefs are not just the words we heard our families say, but they are also communicated through the actions and behaviors we witnessed. And furthermore, what can be really messed up is that we humans tend to say one thing, but model something different. Hence the saying we all know so well, actions speak louder than words. In other words, we might have been getting mixed messages. And so, beliefs about the world we learned from our family can be really sneaky and tough to tease out. Our family may have told us that having a good-paying job was important, but at the same time, referred to wealthy people as corrupt. Or they may have been proud of you for being an exemplary math student, but at the same time, the women in your family said that money and finances were the man's job. Some family beliefs relate to the family identity and may sound like, we are working class people, or we aren't musical people, or we are football people. They could also be expectations set for everyone that live or work in the same town, family business, or the same career fields. These kinds of beliefs could be putting pressure on you to not reject them for fear of losing your place in your family, leaving you feeling guilty or ashamed for wanting to choose something different for yourself. And this guilt could be internal resistance for you that keeps you from pursuing your true passions. You may have seen and decided for yourself that you don't believe in some beliefs, such as racism, sexism, or hate. And you have adopted some beliefs without realizing it, because they were communicated through actions and behaviors modeled for you as a child, and you ended up copying them. Now, some beliefs are worth holding on to if they are healthy for you. And by that, a positive belief is something that is built on integrity, and does not rely on one person or groups of people's rights or needs to be diminished in favor of another person's wants. Beliefs that are fair, just, and balanced are not only worth keeping, but worth fighting for. That does not mean, however, a belief that relies on you putting yourself last to everyone else around you all the time is positive, even if you've been groomed to think that. For example, always setting aside your needs or even wants because you have a responsibility to take care of other people first sounds noble, but isn't fair to you. Likewise, a belief that seems harmless but hurts a lot of women is that we are supposed to hand over major financial responsibilities and decisions in a relationship to the other person and let them handle it. Unfortunately, the evidence shows that this sets you up to be vulnerable if that other person leaves you or dies or chooses to manipulate and control you. Again, this is something we're definitely going to keep talking about. One viewpoint that always teeters on the edge of good and bad is keep trying harder. On one hand, it inspires you to work through difficulties and not give up when things get hard. But on the other hand, it can also keep you trapped in situations that are unwinnable. Also, through this groupthink environment with our family, we pick up on their worldviews. And even if through our own maturation and growth we change our opinions or ideas about something, we still carry the influence of the original thoughts inside of us. And unfortunately, this influence rears its ugly heads in the form of inner voices of self-doubt or unconscious beliefs about ourselves. Quitting the play. Some people may feel that in their family, they had a pretty clear part in the family drama. However, most of us throughout our lives have played different roles at different times, or we played more than one at the same time. In this case, the weight of these roles feels like wearing a bunch of sweaters at the same time, all layered on themselves, limiting movements, and feeling terribly uncomfortable. Roles are so familiar to us because they were the norm for a significant part of our lives. You may not have ever known, however, that you were playing a role, let alone which one. So how can you tell? Well, you will know you are playing a role when you visit with your family and you slide into old patterns, behaviors, or habits that you do not usually do when you are living independently. I noticed that when I went home to visit family, that my usually lighthearted and laid-back demeanor shifted substantially. I would become tense, uptight, and ready for confrontation. Growing up as a teenager and even young adult, I used to say that I could not take a joke. But I am actually a pretty funny person. What I discovered after some time was that at my family's home, teasing and making fun of me was a role I filled for some of them. I was taunted for my beliefs they didn't share, or for my interests in subjects that they didn't understand. So, of course, I couldn't take a joke. I was a child who grew up being the butt of the jokes. But I was also the hero child, the problem solver. As I became older, my role shifted to that of the scapegoat, the truth teller. I began to rebel and stand up for my own needs and principles. But when none of that seemed to matter or change the people around me, I finally became the lost child and moved away for good at 18 years old. The burden of being all these things was overwhelming for most of my life. In fact, even after moving away, I unconsciously replayed these roles in other settings, like my own family and in my businesses. But once I learned what was going on, I finally decided in my 40s to throw my script down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.